Hi everyone, today we are going to discuss on thermal energy conversion systems. Right, we'll discuss briefly. Steam power plants are producing about half of total power requirement in the India. So steam power plants means what? We are going to burn coal or different types of fuels, and we are going to generate the water. We are going to convert into steam. That steam power, it is in turn going to convert that steam, it is going to rotate the turbines and generate the electricity. This is briefly written here. The mechanical energy is converted into electrical energy in a generator. Steam power plants are suitable for large scale
selection of site for
steam power plant. So we'll see one by one the factors. Wherever we want, we cannot set up a steam power plant, but we need to have some brief study about the requirements, that is availability of fuel, transportation, availability of water, ash disposal, nature of land and space area. So one by one briefly we are going to discuss here. Whatever we are saying, the fuel availability of fuel should be large. See here, generally how much we require? A steam power plant using coal as a fuel needs about 1500 tons of coal for every 100 megawatt of fuel is produced. So that is the major requirement. So for every 100 megawatt, if you set up 200 megawatt, we require 3000 tons of coal. So that much availability should be there for production of steam power. So based on the fuel availability, maybe generally we can use coal, petroleum or a natural gas as a fuel. So this is how this availability should be met. Next we will see transportation. We should have a rope, and that is through though having plant at the fuel resource, only if fuel is availability is there, it does not meet the requirement. You should have also transportation for a fuel. It may be away from the place of use. So coal may be available far away from the where we are going to set up a plant. So we need transmission costs and loss of power, hence possible to locate the site. We should have an economical power transmission. Usually we should have a ropeways or a railways are better choice of transportation at the interior places. So sea transportation is economical for the plants and fuel sources near a sea shores. Availability of water. So high volumes of water for use as a feed water we are going to use. Ash handling it is required, and for condensing also it is required. About 50 to 60,000 tons of water per hour is required for every 100 megawatt of power developed. So how much we require? Around 50 to 60,000 tons of water per hour it is required for 100 megawatts. So we need to have a good quality of water for development of energy and also essential for the use of drinking purpose of the employees. So many thousands, 2000 people will be working in that steam power plant. So it requires a good quality of drinking water also. Next. Ash disposal is very important. So generally the steam power plants produce ash about 20 to 30% of fuel burnt. Suppose if I burn 100 kg of fuel, around 20 kg to 30 kg of ash is generated. So where I should throw that? So again, ash disposal is a major problem there. So ash disposal, the ash to be disposed may be several thousand tons per day, right? Several thousand tons a day we require ash disposal. Hence site selected should have provision for proper disposal of ash. Next is nature of land. It is very important. So the soil at the site, whatever we have selected, should have a good bearing capacity, should bear the large forces and structures which we have which will be situated on that. So also we have dynamic forces in operating conditions. So usually how much the bearing capacity it should have? Around 10 kgf per centimeter square. It is essential to set up a steam power plant. So you should keep it in mind. Bearing capacity of soil is very important to withstand huge structures and dynamic forces in operating conditions. Space area. See here. Maximum space area is required as if we compare to other power plants. Around see here, 500 acres of land is necessary for every 100 megawatt of power produced. So 500 acres is not a small amount of land. So it is large amount. If I want to set up 2000 megawatts, I require 1000 acres. So based on, because it has a large equipment, it has a turbine house, it has a boiler house, it has a coal disposal, coal handling system, ash handling system, condensing, cooling towers, chimneys, so many large equipments are situated here. So transportation of fuel is there, transportation of water, transportation of raw materials, so many things. It requires a large, and also for employees we have to construct a residential area. So these are all the requirements of steam power plant. So around 500 acres of land is necessary for 100 megawatt of power produced. So that are the essential requirements. We will see the layout. Important components in the steam power plants are turbine generator, furnace boiler, that is boiler, turbine and generator, fuel handling system, ash handling system, draught system, condensing system, and water cooling system. These are the, and lubrication system is one more, this one. These are the 8 important components and systems of a steam power plant. So this is the figure we need to draw in the exams whenever they ask a layout of steam power plant. So here basically I'll just take a pointer. See, this is the this one boiler. So this is the boiler area, boiler furnace I am just drawing here. So what are the inputs and outputs? So if we just understand, that is more than enough for this, right? So each component input and output we need to understand. So what is the input for the, what is function of boiler? To convert liquid into superheated steam or a steam. So input should be what? Feed water. So here feed water is coming. So input is, first input is feed water. Second one is we have to burn coal and coal inside the boiler to produce this water into steam. So this is coal storage and pulverized, it is coal is coming here. So only fuel is not required, air is also required. So air from the blower. So here water is entering, steam is entering. Air is entering and coal is entering. So within that it is going to burn here. And it is going to produce steam. So what is input for the turbine? Steam. See here, steam is the input. So what is output of the steam? Wet steam. It is going to condenser to convert CR. So this is the condenser. Main important things are boiler, turbine, condenser and pump. So others are accessories. So major, see this turbine, it is going to rotate the turbine, and here it is coupled with the generator to generate the electricity. So here electricity is generated to, it is going to transmit it further through the transmission lines. Now what is condenser? Condenser is a device where hot steam is converted into liquid. How it is converted? So we have the cooling tower. Using cooling tower, each and every explanation component explained in the future slides we will see there. So here what is the output of the boiler? Ash. So ash is coming out, ash handling system, ash to the sump it is going to store. So condenser, this economizer, so I'll explain generator, in the future part. Cooling tower also function is written here in the future part.
This is the central layout power of steam system power
plant where electrical energy is generated. So how electrical energy is generated? Using the turbine generator coupling. So this in this turbine, velocity and pressure energy of the steam is converted into kinetic energy. These turbines are directly coupled to the generators which develop the electricity. I have explained already. So steam turbines are used either impulse or reaction turbine based on the requirement. Turbines are equipped with the governing systems to control
next
the
boiler
of the plant.
What is function of
this
boiler?
Is very important. This is the unit plant where steam is generated by burning the fuels. So whatever I have written here, explained in that only, that is written here. The type of fuel used may be solid, liquid or a gas. Combination of fuel is also possible. Water is used to raise the steam, must be free from suspended or dissolved impurities, because it may obstruct the flow or it may corrode the tubes, whatever may be the problems it may have. The impulse water may lead to scale formation, and that is what I said, corrosion and other things. These may hamper the boiler operation. Next is fuel handling system. So ash handling system, we'll see here. So ash produced in a steam power plant amounts to 10 to 20% of the fuel burnt, what I already explained while selection of the plant only. This should be removed from the furnace and disposed. This is done by proper ash handling system. This system may be used either mechanical, hydraulic or pneumatic or a steam jet type. We are going to explain one by one in the future slides. This selection is based on the quantity of ash to be handled and type of boiler used. Draught system. See here, draught is very important. This system is essential to supply the required quantity of air for the combustion of the fuel. See, I said fuel plus air, it is going to combustion process is going to take place. We have studied already in the chemistry also, we have studied, and applied thermodynamics also we have studied. To force the flue gases through the furnace of the boiler systems and finally discharge the gases through the atmosphere through the chimney. Final. So whatever air which we are supplying for the combustion, it is going to convert it into, initially it is called as air, and as it mixes with the fuel, it converts into flue gases. Those gases till final discharge, that system which takes care, it is called as draught system. The draught system may be either natural or mechanical type, we'll see in the future. Condensing system, already I said. Condenser, what is the use of condenser? It is used for minimizing the higher temperature, that is higher temperature steam or a wet steam, it is going to condense into the liquid form. This increases the efficiency of the plant. Generally, water to steam type condensers are used with the necessary pumping. Water cooling system. The quantity of water used to condensing the steam is very high, and it should be reused in the condenser. The water gets heated up after the condensing. See here, what is use of condenser? It is going to convert steam into liquid. So liquid, whether it is in the hot condition or cool condition, it is, we don't know. So that hot water, whenever it is having, we need to cool it using cooling towers, right? So this water gets heated up after condensing the steam, and this water is to be cooled for recirculation. This is achieved by cooling towers, as I said, where water is pumped to a high altitude and allowed to flow over the baffles. During this, water gets cooled, which is pumped back to the condensing unit. So there, a recirculation purpose, it is there. Lubrication system. See here, so many parts will be moving, sliding, rotating, oscillating. So these are all require these will be having frictional power in that. So they require the lubrication. The turbines and generators are running at high speeds around 3000 RPM. A proper lubrication system is essential to keep the system running continuously. The lubrication system not only avoids wear and tear but also provides a little cooling effect for the bearing of the system. Other accessories. So other accessories will be explaining in the details: economizer, superheater, desuperheater, reheater, air preheater, soot blowers and furnace cleaning units. Fuels for steam generation, we'll see now what fuels we are going to use. Steam power plant uses fossil fuels to generate the steam. Fossil fuels means this coal, petrol, diesel and other things. The fuel may be in different forms such as solid, liquid or a pulverized or a gaseous. See, solid we know that solid it is in the form of lumps, liquid it is in the form of liquid particles. Pulverized and gaseous means, gas means in the form of gaseous form and pulverized means in a powdered particles. So it is called as pulverized. The selection of the type of fuel depends on the availability of fuel. If the natural gas is available, we are going to use the gas for burning. If a large quantity of petrol diesels are available, we are going to burn petrol and diesel. And if wood, coal, charcoal are available, we are going to use those fuels for burning. Depends upon the availability of the fuel and economic conditions. Types of fuels we have seen: solid, liquid and gaseous fuels. Solid fuels, we will see coal. Coal is the major fuel used for thermal power plants to generate the steam. Coal occurs in nature. You have studied about the coal, how it is generated. It is generated by the decaying of vegetable matters buried before million years ago under the pressure and heat. This phenomenon of transportation of vegetable matter into coal under the earth crust is known as metamorphism. So this is how you need to know how it is produced. The coal available under in different forms, we'll see this. The major constituents of coal: the moisture is around 5 to 40%, volatile matter that is combustible or incombustible are 50%, and ash is 20 to 50%. The chemical substances in the coal are, these are the carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen and sulfur. In metamorphism phenomena, the vegetable matters undergo a transportation from peat to anthracite. You know that peat, lignite, bituminous and anthracite coal, which intermediate forms are lignite and bituminous. So these are the four different types of coals. Liquid fuels. Right. So petroleum or a crude oil consists of 80 to 85% of carbon, 10 to 15% hydrogen, and varying percentage of sulfur, nitrogen, oxygen and compounds of vanadium. The crude oil is refined by fractional distillation process to obtain the fuel oils for industrial as well as for domestic purpose. The fractions from the light oil to heavy oil are naphtha, gasoline, kerosene, diesel and finally heavy fuel oil. So some of the advantages are given here, just we'll go through this. Advantages: use of liquid fuels in the thermal power plants have advantages. Storage and handling is easy. The excess air required for combustion is less. Fire control can be done easily. No requirements of ash handling because it completely is going to burn. The system is very clean and hence the labor required is relatively less. Gaseous fuels are either natural gas or manufactured gases. We need to use manufactured gases are costlier than the natural gas because we need to have a manufacturing that. Generally natural gases are used for power plants such as available in the abundance. So this is about the natural gas. Major constituents are 60 to 65% is methane and others are small in quantity. It can be transported through pipelines distance for several hundred kilometers, right? It's colorless, odorless and non-toxic. Calorific frequency ranges from 25 to 50 kilojoules per meter cube. So about the gaseous fuels written here. Fuel feeding and firing systems. So we'll see the fuel feeding and firing systems. So major, how to feed the fuel and fire, how to make it to fire and generate the, that is the thing here. In India, steam power plants use coal as a fuel. Since coal is a major source, it is available in abundance. Power plants with the smaller outputs are using liquid fuels like diesel oil and heavy oil. The major steam power plants run by the burning the coal. Coal is generally referred as a fuel which is used for either solid or a powder form. So there are these are the different type methods. That is, if it is a solid fuel, if you are going to use, we are going to go for two methods. That is hand firing. Second one is mechanical stroker firing. If we are going to in the form of powder, that is pulverized fuel, EOD system or a central or bin system, we are going to use. Hand firing. Through the hand firing is simple and cheaper, but it's not generally used because of low combustion efficiency, slow response to the load fluctuations, combustion control is difficult. Means you are going to just fire it and you are going to take the output of the coal. That is not usually generally used. These are two important. Mechanical stokers we are going to use. So why we are going to use the stokers? Combustion is more efficient here, fuel handling is automatic and easier, faster response to load fluctuations. Low quality fuels can be successfully burnt, suitable for small to high capacity plants. So how it is going to work? It is going to work on two methods, overfeed stoker and underfeed stokers. The principle of overfeed stokers, we will just go to the diagram itself, see here. So overfeed stokers, so this is the diagram. So here green coal, incandescent means incompletely burned coke, ash are fed from the top, and air is primary air which is going to enter from the bottom. So overfeed stokers means from the top the fuel is going to be fed and air is going to pass from the bottom. See here. The hot air then passes through the bed of the air. The part of the carbon dioxide formed reacts with the carbon in the fuel form to carbon monoxide. So this is whatever reactions are going to happen, it is written here. So this is one power plant picture, you can see here, steam power plant. Underfeed stokers, see here. What is difference between overfeed? The coal is charged from the bottom, there from the top, and the primary air comes from the bottom through the holes of the grate. So this is the difference. We will directly go through the diagram. See here. From the bottom, the coal is fed and air, primary air is coming from, is also bottom. That is, primary air is coming also from the, along with the, this one, it is going to carry the secondary air. All of you keep in mind why secondary air is applied for complete combustion. Suppose some of the particles are left burned without burning. So if you supply the secondary air, it is going to mix with the air and it is going to catch fire again. So that is overfeed stokers and underfeed stokers. In operation of the primary air entering from the bottom through the grate comes in contact with the green coal and then passes through the bed of incandescent coke. Initially, air reacts with the carbon in the coke or to form carbon dioxide, and moisture of the air reacts to release the carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide and hydrogen. So explanation is written here. This method is most suitable for semi-bituminous and bituminous coals which have higher volatility.